This is Radio 314 on the Red Ice Radio Network.
Welcome back, everyone. This is Lana. Well, for this interview, I've decided to veer in a completely different direction from the last few topics just to try something new. It's funny, though, because when I end up choosing someone to discuss a non-political issue, it always seems to go there anyway. And there are times when I'm pleased, and then there are times when I cringe, regret it, and don't want to release the interview. So this time around, we'll be discussing plant intelligence with Stephen Herod Buhner, who's the author of 19 books, including Plant Intelligence and the Imaginal Realm, The Lost Language of Plants and Sacred Plant Medicine. He has taught for more than 30 years throughout North America and Europe. Can the subject of plants become political? You bet. Hi, Stephen. Welcome to the program.
Hi. Thanks for having me on.
Well, you've written 19 books revolving around plants. So how did you come to study the realm of plants?
Well, my great-grandfather was a physician who primarily used botanic medicines. He started practice in 1911, and they didn't really have many pharmaceuticals then. And I spent a lot of time with him on his farm in Indiana, and that's sort of what oriented me toward the healing professions and wanting to do something more kind of old-fashioned, I guess you might say, and not so technological. And then just with the whole human potential movement that happened in the 60s and 70s and kind of the development of massage therapy and different psychotherapeutic techniques and all of that. And eventually in the early 80s, I wandered into herbal medicine, and it was just a great fit for me.
Wow. Well, James Lovelock was the scientist who first theorized that our planet is a self-regulating biological entity, which is known as the Gaia hypothesis. However, I'd say this concept of a Mother Earth has been in the psyche of our European ancestors for thousands of years, but today we can have a deeper understanding of it. So share with us the concept of plant intelligence.
Well, the fascinating thing about Jim Lovelock's work is that he was showing that there is this kind of livingness in the world that we'd really been taught for a long time that wasn't there. And, you know, we've been trained in the West to pretty much look at the world around us as a static backdrop, or, you know, and human beings are kind of the only intelligent actors that are sort of walking across that stage. But that was never really very accurate. It really came out of 19th century thinking and early 20th century thinking, and it turns out that what people call nonlinearity or chaos theory, the tendency for biological organisms to sort of self-organize, which Gaia is the largest example of that, is extremely pervasive here. And every time that happens, the organisms have to be able to do a lot of things. They have to be able to tell the difference between me and not me. They have to be able to tell the intent of an organism that's coming toward them. They have to be able to craft responses, all of which is highly intelligent behavior. And it turns out literally every biological organism on the planet is really highly intelligent. Human beings are in some ways much less intelligent than some of those entities. So when you start looking at bacteria and plants, for instance, what you start finding is this tremendous intelligence level with extremely sophisticated neural networks like we have in our brain, and they're able to do all of those things plus a lot more. They plan for the future, they teach their offspring, and so this is sort of upsetting that older, more reductionistic look of things. And all of this really was pretty much inherent in Lovelock's Gaia orientation.
That's why I like to tell vegetarians, well, plants have feelings too.
They had definitely have feelings. And what's more than that, as I talk about in the book, some plants are far more intelligent than human beings. So that sort of, you know, thing of like somebody's in a coma, they call them a vegetable, that's sort of our orientation toward plants, but they're actually, in general, they tend to be a lot smarter than most people, no matter what plant you're looking at. I mean, they can't run, they can't hide, they can't go to the doctor, they can't call the police, they can't call, you know, go to the hospital or whatever like that. They have to craft all of these responses, and they're really good at creating sophisticated chemicals to do so and to coordinate and communicate with everything around them. They're actually tremendously fascinating.
Well, let's talk about the plant brain, because you write about how brains don't actually have to look like the human sense of the word, right?
Right, they don't have to at all. And really what's important is not the brain, but the neural network that the brain contains. And so a lot of people that are doing studies of neural networks and intelligence in neural networks, they really are calling what most neuroscientists and consciousness researchers have been doing for a long time, a kind of brain chauvinism, because they're so focused on the organ that they've missed the important thing, which is the neural network. Now, you know, reductionists who like to call themselves skeptics or whatever, they always like to jump on this sort of thing, and I think it's fascinating that the first person who in print identified the plant brain was Charles Darwin in his second to last book, The Power of Movement in Plants. And so what happens is the plant brain is really the root system. And when you examine it, as many plant neurobiologists have done, you find it's got the same kind of neuronal structures that our brains do. They use the same neurotransmitters. They act very much identically to our own brain, our neural network. And the other thing is they're not limited by the size of a skull. Our brain development is limited by our skull size. Plant roots can grow forever in the soil. That's the medium. So that's how you get, you know, aspen root systems or aspen organisms that are over 100,000 years old, where the root systems cover hundreds of acres, and their neural network far exceeds our own.
Well, you mentioned some plants are smarter than others. So how so?
Well, it's just like anything else. You know, there's all living organisms have a range of intelligence level, you know. I mean, we've all noticed that in people because we've all been around long enough to have encountered that range. You
know? A plant bell curve?
Yeah, there's a plant bell curve just like there is amongst human beings. But it might even be more accurate to think of it looking at human beings as just being part of the mammal species, and you're going to get a range of intelligence or a range of sophistication of neural net, might be a better way to put it, across the whole mammal spectrum. And you're going to find that same thing among plants. Some have massive neural networks like that aspen tree system that I just mentioned. Others, like a single rye plant, will have about 16 billion neurons. Human beings have about 86 billion, but the aspen system will have trillions of neurons. So you get an idea of that just similar kind of range.
Well, bacteria, they don't have a brain, yet they must be intelligent, because it seems like the more antibiotics we try to kill them with, the more resistant they become, right?
Yeah, they're supremely intelligent. I mean, they're the oldest life form on the planet. So, you know, they've been around somewhere between 3.5 and 4 billion years. And what they have is they have really sophisticated neural networks that they've developed that look different than a plant or a human neural network, but they perform exactly the same function. And so what happens with bacteria, they sort of all hook together almost in a superorganism. You might call them a swarm intelligence, in which the neural network capacities of a single bacterium hook together with all of the others, and you get this neural network that there is nothing on the planet that is larger than that particular neural network. And many people have remarked that those bacteria, if you touch bacteria in one part of the earth and do something to them, that information will travel around the planet extremely rapidly. And that's one of the ways they started figuring out that they're more like a global superorganism rather than isolated individual entities.
Wow. Well, what is your take on the bacteria relationship with us? Does the virus-host relationship offer any benefits?
Well, the interesting thing is, if you look at Lynn Margulis's work, I mean, you know, all of this stuff, I like to continually say, all this stuff we're talking about is information that's been carefully concealed in peer-reviewed journals where most, you know, researchers can't find it, you know. So the thing is, like, when you look at Lynn Margulis's work, she worked with bacteria for all of her life, and she was the one that began to realize that all complex biological organisms were simply bacteria that had morphed into a more sophisticated shape, innovated from a process she called symbiogenesis, where two organisms that are unlike each other merge and form a completely third organism that has the capacities of both of the original ones and other ones that can't be predicted from studying those first ones. So, you know, and one of the things she continually said is bacteria are our ancestors. They invented consciousness. They invented neural networks. So when we attack bacteria, we're engaging in this kind of form of self-hatred. You know, but even if you look at it more reductively than that, the surface of our body is covered with bacteria. Our GI tract is covered with bacteria. We've co-evolved with them, and if they were removed from our bodies, we would die pretty much immediately. Without that sort of collaborative behavior, our life, no advanced life or more complex life form could exist.
Well, if we talk about invasive plants, they obviously have a function. So what can you tell us about the purpose of invasive plants as we know them?
Well, the thing is, you have to understand, plants have tremendous power of movement. Nobody can really quite figure out how plant populations move across the world, but every time they do mathematical analysis of it, they don't move by random dynamics. There's really sophisticated nonlinear periodicity, they would say, going on. And so, you know, the Earth moves on much longer timelines than we're used to. So the fascinating thing about invasive plants, they, you know, we're sort of taught that somebody brought the seed back. It was on their shoe when they went to, you know, Belgium or something, and they bring back to the United States and it starts to spread. But really, when you really look more deeply into it, you start seeing that the plants that move into particular areas all do so for specific reasons. They're actually counteracting long-term ecological damage in that location, and they begin to rectify the problem by being there. And after a while, they'll move on and other plants will come in once the soil's restored and the ecosystem is more balanced. Now, a great way to get an idea of this, because I know about plants best, but when you look at the zebra mussel, which is something everybody keeps bringing up as this horrible invasive pest, it's in the Great Lakes system in the United States. And so it's really incredibly fascinating to me because the Great Lakes are tremendously polluted and they've killed off a lot of the natural life that lived in there for thousands of years. And one of the things that began to die off or began severely reduced in numbers were all of the normal mussels and oysters that lived in that location. Plus, they built all these huge industrial plants around the Great Lakes, which continually polluted them. So they're not actually very healthy places. Well, when the zebra mussels moved in, one of the functions of mussels and oysters, for instance, is they filter the water. A single zebra mussel can filter about 3 gallons of water per hour. And so you get these millions of zebra mussels who are in there that are acting as a massive filtering mechanism to clean the lakes. But secondly, the one thing that they really like to do after that is clog the intake ports and the exit ports of all of these industrial factories. So they're screwing up their plumbing system, stopping them from being able to continue to pollute. So that's why I say that whenever you're looking at an invasive species, you have to ask, what's its ecological function? Why is it moving into that area? And invariably, you find that they're doing something to correct an underlying ecological disruption.
Yeah, many people think that dandelions are weeds just to be mowed down, but they're shining their little yellow faces at us, begging to be picked and consumed because they're also highly beneficial for humans. I mean, I always have dandelion tea in my house. It's the go-to herb. Nettles also like that. It grows in ditches and around old barns and cars. It's also great for medicinal properties.
Yeah, they're two absolutely great plants for healing disease. And you start to see these growing in certain locations, but dandelion's extremely good for liver problems, which a lot of people suffer from. Nettle's really good for as a tonic for people that are really run down or they're nutritively diminished somehow. And so it's always really important to look at what these things are doing and to understand that you know, there's a lot more going out in nature than we've been led to believe. I mean, we just don't notice how incredibly wondrous it is.
Yeah, I know. Well, many people today say humans are a plague, and some are probably, but not all. So what do plants get from us?
Well, as a friend of mine said once, she said, it's their journey too. And I love thinking about it that way. When you really start getting into plants and human beings and you start looking at it, there's this terrible suspicion that begins to emerge, this dawning realization that's really hard to put down after years of looking at it, that human beings serve as plant propagators. I mean, we're the ones that carry them all around the earth. And you have to understand, plants are tremendously older than human beings, anywhere from 140 to 700 million years, depending upon what you're looking at, what your criteria are. And they and bacteria are the two most fundamental organisms to life on earth. The way the whole earth ecosystem is couldn't be here. If all the bacteria died, everything else would die. If all of the plants died, the bacteria would still be here, but human life would cease to exist extremely rapidly. So they're much more fundamental to everything here than we are. We're sort of Johnny-come-lately after effects, in a sense. And so because of that, we were sort of emerged into an existing system. And one of the things, the major things plants get from us is we move them around the earth and help distribute their seeds. I mean, it's more like we're the dog and they're the person walking us.
So do you think humans serve an ecological function on the planet?
Yeah, I think humans, you know, that's one of the things I talk about in the book, that I think humans serve a really important ecological function. And you know, I've been working on that, thinking about that for about 20 years. The whole concept that human beings are a plague on the earth, or a cancer, or a virus, I'm sure you've heard that, and lot of people listening have heard that sort of phrasing, and it just never really sat well with me. I mean, it's a great way to, you know, sort of give energy to feelings of guilt, but it didn't really seem to serve any function. And if you look at the Gaia hypothesis, the Earth is a living, intelligent, aware organism, it would be really strange for an organism that's 4 billion years old to make that kind of an error in judgment, to generate an organism which was going to destroy the very biosphere itself. So I started looking at it with new eyes and really asking, what's the ecological function? And what's really fascinating is that if you start looking at sexual reproduction on the earth, I mean, that's one of the things the earth loves. The earth is engaging in sex all of the time. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll is ecologically fundamental to the functioning of the planet, actually. And so then if you start looking at the innovations, Gaia, I think a better word for evolution is actually innovation. Gaia is always innovating, and Gaia is always creating more complex ecological structures, because the more complex they are, the better able they are to respond to perturbations in their functioning, like asteroid strikes or something like that. So one of the things Gaia does to keep everything really healthy is blending genomes all around the planet. And about 140 million years ago or so, Gaia started getting really interested in split gender sexuality. Gaia had been playing around with that for quite a while, maybe 700 million years, something like that. And then that was a really great innovation. You start looking at how plants propagate. You also get this, first they had wind pollination. That was the earliest form. And then with the emergence of flowering plants about 140 million years ago, Gaia had this even greater idea, which was you get the pollinator to take the pollen exactly where it needs to go rather than relying on the wind. You combine that with Lynn Margulis's understanding that there were just four original bacteria that gave rise to all of the organisms on Earth. And then you start looking at what human beings have done. Now, human beings have done a very similar thing that plants do, that plants store up all of this material over the winter, and then in the spring, and then the summer, and then in the fall, they start putting out seed, and they use those stored resources to create seed stock, which they then release into the world to propagate. So Richard Dawkins said this thing once. He said, Gaia is not alive because Gaia doesn't reproduce. And I thought, well, that's a really strange thing for an 80-year-old person to say about, or somebody that's going to live 80 years, to say about an organism that's 4 billion years old. How would he know if Gaia only reproduces every million years, for instance? So the thing is that as we create all of these rocket ships and everything and send them out into space and all of our space probes, they're covered with bacteria, and we're actually sending them out into space to
like
all of these
panspermia
different planets.
Panspermia type of thing?
Yeah, that's exactly like panspermia. I mean, a lot of people have speculated that life on Earth started because bacteria from out there came here. And what's actually happening is we're sending bacteria from here out all throughout the solar system, throughout the galaxy, and into the universe. Gaia's really reproducing. And they found that these bacteria, they found them on the moon, they found them on the Mars Land Rover, they found them on the International Space Station, that they're actually able to go into this hibernative state in space and last pretty much indefinitely. So that's, I think, the ecological function of the human species. We've used up all of this stored resource base that Gaia had built up over 100,000 years, basically as part of a reproduction process. And we're important to Gaia, we're just not fundamental.
Right. You have a chapter in your book called Gaia and the Patterns That Connect, where you write about the similarities between plants and humans seen in the female reproductive system and in the fundamentals of sex. And it's incredible to see the imagery of this, but tell us about these aspects.
Well, what's really fascinating, I mean, a lot of people have noticed this, that the flower reproductive system and the human female reproductive system are virtually identical. And then a lot of people have also noticed that plants produce estrogenic compounds which affect the human reproductive system or the female reproductive system. So, you know, Gregory Bateson was absolutely a fascinating guy, and he realized there were all of these what he called meta patterns in nature, like an egg shape, like nuts have an egg shape. It's a really sophisticated kind of innovation. But you start looking at the development of that particular kind of reproductive system, Gaia always tends to take that pattern if it's successful and then use it in succeeding innovations. And so what you see is that, yet it was used in the flowers, then it was used in other species, including mammals, including human females. But once you really understand that, once you understand you're looking at a meta pattern, and you apply it also to split gender sexuality, because when you start really looking closely at the male and female reproductive tracts, they're virtually identical. They're just slightly morphed for function. Like the prostate and the uterus are virtually an identical organ. The testicles and the ovaries are virtually identical organs. So you put all of that stuff together, and what you begin to understand is flowers are going to be menstruating, because there's a reason for menstruation, which is one major reason is that sterilizes the female reproductive tract. And in fact, flowers do menstruate. We just happen to call it nectar. They put this very sweet substance filled with antibacterial compounds all up through into the flower, which helps prevent infection. Then if you understand that the female and male reproductive systems are virtually identical, then you have to understand that not only are plants going to be creating estrogenic chemicals, they're going to be creating androgenic chemicals. And of course, pine pollen has pharmaceutically pure testosterone in it, just like in our bodies. And so then you can also get, if the uterus and the prostate are identical organs, just morphed for function, then a plant that's going to affect the prostate, saw palmetto, which is an endocrine modulator, it's also going to be able to be used to normalize uterine function. So you begin to see how all of these things are connected together in this most marvelous network of all of these patterns that are working together.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, you went further, even talked about the male and semen and testosterone, which is fascinating, actually.
Yeah, I think that it is. It's like that's the more I learn about all this, the more I realize I don't know, and also the more fascinating it all becomes for me. I mean, it's just a marvelous kind of journey to go into the world without preconceptions and begin to see what's really there rather than what I was taught in school, which most of which was useless.
Oh, yeah. Well, you mentioned pine trees were high in testosterone. I know these days men have dangerously low testosterone levels, and you've written a book called Vital Man. So, what recommendations do you have for men to boost their testosterone?
Well, the thing is that there's massive amounts of estrogenic chemicals going into the
Oh, yeah.
ecosystem, and one of the major sources of that is hormone replacement therapy that women take. One of the reasons why when people take pharmaceuticals that they have to keep taking them is that it goes into the body and the body naturally tries to get rid of it, and so it's usually excreted out of the body somehow. A lot of it is excreted out in urine, and so it goes into the water supply at these really tiny levels, parts per trillion. And it turns out that those parts per trillion of estrogenic chemicals are very, very potent in their impacts. A lot of people thought that the levels were too minute to make any difference, but in fact, it turns out that they're a lot more active at parts per trillion than they are at parts per hundred. So what you get from people that are studying this is that they're now starting to notice there's massive effects on male reproductive systems all around the earth. And it's not just hormone replacement therapies. Of course, there's a lot of estrogen mimics from plastics and other things that are doing the similar thing. So I began to look, it took me about 10 years. I don't know why I was so slow, but it took me about 10 years before I began looking for androgenic or phytoandrogens. And the weird thing is, it just took me so long to think of it. I'd been working with phytoestrogens for a decade, and all of a sudden I just went, yeah, there's got to be phytoandrogens. And it turns out that pine pollen has more testosterone in it than any other plant on Earth or any other plant part on Earth. And so taking a tincture of pine pollen is extremely effective because it's absorbed through the mucous membranes of the mouth and throat directly into the bloodstream, and it'll raise testosterone levels and actually counteract a lot of the problems that low testosterone causes in the human male. It's quite magnificent, really.
Wow. Yeah, and I know for women with high estrogen, you don't want that because, well, it makes you crazy, and also you can your chances of getting cancer are higher. So there's plants you can take that are, we need more progesterone because that's a precursor to testosterone to balance out the high levels of estrogen.
Right, and women have testosterone in their bodies too, and what's most important for both men and women is the estrogen testosterone ratio. And that's why for men, what happens in middle age is that there's a very definite shift where the estrogen testosterone ratio moves more toward the estrogen side, and so men begin to gain more weight at that time, they begin to slow down a
They
bit,
get
all different.
breasts.
Yeah, they do. The moob experience, as it's unfortunately known in the United States.
Yeah.
And so women start to have similar dynamics at various different times. So the important thing is to like balance those ratios. And plants are extremely good at doing that because there's very few side effects from them. They're biodegradable, which most pharmaceuticals are not actually biodegradable, which most people don't know. And they're renewable, and they're very inexpensive. So I love them. I use them all the time.
Well, speaking of testosterone, it and the male purpose seems to be demonized, and that's an issue I have with many of the Gaia goddess worshipping types because they only talk about the goddess aspect and seem to resent males. But what you're talking about is the balance between male and female on the planet, right?
Yeah, I am. And that was actually the whole point of feminism and its original emergence, is not to suppress the male, not to supplant, one kind of totalitarianism with another, but basically for this kind of equality and recognition to begin to occur. And the more I understand about how that men and women are actually extremely, I mean, we're really taught in a lot of ways that there's two species of human beings on Earth, men and women, but there's not. There's one, and split gender sexuality just means there's this human identity at the core of this, and that one, you know, it's morphed toward the male or morphed toward the female simply for genetic recombination because it's more healthy. And so, you know, it's a real difficult thing being immersed in the midst of my liberal tribe as long as I have been, and being at so many conferences and festivals and events like this, running into male hatred or sex hatred like that has been a continual process. And unfortunately, amongst my liberal tribe, we've had the same difficulty speaking up about that and trying to moderate it as people in the extreme right wing have done about fundamentalist Christianity or any other kind of fundamentalism. So it is a real definite problem, and I can't actually see how, you know, hatred between the sexes is going to get us to a better place.
Oh, of course not. It's ridiculous. And it's being spread everywhere in the universities right now, that type of teaching, unfortunately. So,
yeah, it kind of, you know, and I've been watching this for a long time. We often will get some really neat innovation addressing some problem that needs to be addressed. And there'll be this massive kind of exploration and all this wonderful stuff that happens. And then all of those people sort of, they either begin to die off or they begin to move on. And then the most fundamentalist sort of regressive, reductionistic members of that movement begin to sort of take over the whole shebang. And it's, you know, I've seen it happen. It's happened in psychoanalysis. There is much less innovation, much more conservatism now. It's starting to happen in herbal medicine quite a bit. It happened in the medical profession. It happened in physics and in science. It just seems to be a common dynamic. And I love Doris Lessing, who was a great writer in England for a long time, and she talked about this a lot. She said, you know, for every one person that uses this information about equality between the sexes to actually change, there's nine others that are using it to gain power over others. And she said it's simply unconscionable.
I think the whole idea of egalitarianism is a farce, though, because we don't see it in nature at all.
Well, yeah, but we do see cooperation, and where the sort of, you know, the diversity of life and function comes together in an incredibly cooperative way. One of the real truths that you find as you start getting deeper into the whole Gaia dynamic is that cooperation is a lot more fundamental than competition. That whole thing about nature being red in tooth and claw is actually not that accurate. What's really accurate is you have a fundamentally cooperative system in which death is inherently embedded. It can't be removed from the system. And that's one of the things that people have a lot of difficulty dealing with. It's like, you know, the thing is, we're supposed to biodegrade. We're biodegrading right now. But the thing is, you get in the midst of my liberal community and you say, and they go, yeah, biodegrading is really fun. You know, I really believe in that. You go, well, we're biodegrading. And they go, no, that's not okay. I have to go to the hospital right now. So there's that fear of death has sort of been in there, and we can't look at it or seem to accept that it's a fundamental aspect of things. But you get away from that, or you understand its inherent nature, and you begin to find cooperation is fundamental in the system, and that all of the differences that are occurring in all the different organisms, it's because they have a function. They have an inherent genius to contribute from what and who they are to the functioning of the whole. And I just think that's one of the most marvelous things about it.
Well, if we back up a little bit, you've spoken about how sex is woven into the fabric of our planet, and in your book you kind of get into how people can be shameful to talk about it, and it makes me think of the story of Adam and Eve and how they became shameful being naked. And to me it symbolizes the defilement of our ancestors by this Judaic myth religion that got into the psyche of our European ancestors and cut them off from their ancient grounded ways. You know, I was raised Christian, and it's not a religion that depicts sex and nature as a positive force. What do you think?
Well, it's a really kind of bizarre thing because in the early days of Christianity, that wasn't an issue. It's another real example of how the most restrictive, crazy, fundamentalist members of the movement sort of began to take things over after a while. And I think part of it was really in response to the Romans. The Romans, you know, were fascinating. They didn't have the same sort of orientation toward nudity or sex that we do. It's like I've just been reading a massive amount of work by Mary Beard, who's English, and I just love her work. She's absolutely brilliant. And so, you know, so in Roman bathrooms, there were no stalls, right? It was just a line of toilets. And so everybody just walked in and sat down next to each other and did their business, you know. But when we would think of that, it's like we start to get real twitchy about it. So the other thing they would do, they didn't have the nudity taboo like we do. So that during sex, the man and woman would be in their bedroom having sex, and they would get into all of these different interesting positions, and they would call in their slaves or their servants and say, oh, you know, we're having trouble with this position. Will you help us get into this one or that one? And it's like, when you think about us doing that now, everybody goes, oh, my God, I could never do that. So, but the dynamic about shame about body, shame about sexuality, it all came from this very definite shift. And I think part of what was happening with Christianity over time is that they were really reacting against the Roman orientation to sort of set themselves up as different. And, you know, the fascinating thing about a nudity taboo, once it's put in place, children don't understand it. Little kids always take off their clothes because it feels good to run around naked. They just do that. You have to train them over and over and over again to keep them on. And then they're like, well, why? And the parents don't really have an answer. Well, you just have to, or it's not nice to be without clothes or whatever. And so for kids, what they start doing is the only way to explain that is that they make up there's something wrong with naked bodies. They have to. It's inevitable. And it also gets translated to a personal thing. They make up that there's something wrong with their body because that's the only way to explain it, even though nobody ever says what it is that's actually quite wrong with the body. And so one of the ways that I like to get to this is with people, I lead them into kind of this, you know, exercise, meditative exercise, and they get really calm, and I say, okay, now I'd like you to see standing in front of you the ugliest part of your body. And every time you do that, it's very vivid. Somebody will see whatever. And the fascinating thing is the amazing range of body parts that are chosen to be the ugly one, right? Everybody's different. But the thing is, like, just looking at those parts and talking to them in that exercise, you know, the part invariably sort of says back to the person during the meditation, well, all I really want to be is loved. All I want you to do is have me be part of you and not sort of have this divisive thing for you to once again, you know, own the beauty of your body and for us to be happy together. And that's a tremendous act of cultural defiance to do something like that.
Well, moving away from body parts and getting back into plants, another aspect I wanted to ask you about is regarding plant intelligence and environmentalism. So what do you make of humanity's environmentalism today?
Environmentalism is a really strange thing. I think also the same thing. I think in the beginning, when you look at the work of Aldo Leopold, for instance, or Arne Neff, Aldo Leopold is considered sort of the father of American environmentalism, modern American environmentalism from the 30s and the 40s, Arne Næss from Norway, I think, of European, and then of course there was Henry Thoreau and John Muir and John Burroughs, a bunch of other people in the American thing, and they were doing some really interesting stuff. They were sort of raising awareness about what we were losing and the livingness of the world, and that was really important. But over time, environmentalism has become a big part of the problem. In my opinion, a lot of the environmental organizations are extremely wealthy, extremely powerful, and they have become their own reason for being. And they're just as misguided in many ways as a lot of the people that they're combating. There isn't any way that we can destroy the planet. It's not going to happen. There's not really any way that we're going to destroy ourselves. What's really at risk is human civilization, the technological civilization that we've built up over the last, 500 years, let's say. That's very much endangered because it's based on extracting resources from what we consider to be sort of a static environment from which we can pull as much as we want. And that's definitely in trouble, and it's not really savable. If you really start looking at everything, we've already exceeded the carrying capacity of the Earth. We're literally burning the house to keep warm in the winter, and we're right up against limits of all different kinds, not just peak oil, but peak topsoil, peak water, peak everything, and the system is starting to fray and crack everywhere. And I think that's part of the reason why so many people are so afraid. It's that they can just feel this thing happening, and there's really not much that they can do to stop it.
For me, it's, I used to laugh when I heard about, overpopulation. But now when you really travel and when you really get out, it's like, wow, there is a lot of people,
Well, in the United States, it was something like there's an additional 100 million people now since 1980. So I notice it here. Everybody does. And I know in England it's a real problem because simply housing and housing prices, land prices. And we see it here. There's very little stuff available for people that's affordable because we're all bumping up against each other, and it's starting to really fray because we're not really cultures that are used to that kind of population density.
Yeah. Well, a lot of it is mass immigration, which Europe and America is getting hit with. And I'm surprised that environmentalists who worry about overpopulation don't say anything about it.
Well, the problem is once you start talking about overpopulation, you get into a real dicey area. There's no way out that you can't escape from that, the implications of talking about that. And pretty soon you're into, well, somehow the population of the Earth is going to have to decrease substantially. And if we don't somehow decide how to do it ourselves, nature will do it for us. Mm-hmm. Whether it's going to be massive epidemic diseases like Ebola, sooner or later something like that will break out into the human community. And as the way the United States Health Service showed, they're just completely incapable of dealing with it. It almost got loose this time. Sooner or later something like that will get loose. So it's either going to happen for us, or we're going to have to, really grasp the nettle ourselves and begin to deal with it directly. But I don't see much chance of that. It's too hard of a problem for human beings to directly face. The implications are too serious, and the ways to address it are too totalitarian and too frightening, and nobody's going to want to go there.
Well, it kind of is, when I think about it, survival of the fittest that way. I'm like, if you're not smart and you're eating the GMOs and using the chemicals and wearing the polyester, nature might take you out.
Well, it's an interesting thing, that the survival of the fittest dynamic, that's not actually a phrase that Darwin initiated.
Sure,
it was Herbert Spencer that came up with that. And so Darwin was really different. He said there is no hierarchy. There's no higher. He had a sign in his office that said, there's no higher or lower. Remember that, And when you start really looking at survival of the fittest dynamics, yes, sometimes that's true, but there's also survival of the luckiest. And that's a really common dynamic that's very much overlooked by what the Harvard zoologist Richard Lewontin calls the vulgar Darwinist, which I think is a hilarious phrase. But so there's a lot of other factors involved rather than simply that, one guy runs faster than the other sort of dynamic. And so mostly, because when you start looking at survival of the fittest orientation, everybody starts getting afraid and they want to hunker down over their can of pork and beans with, a 30-06, at least here in America, that's the way they do it. And so it gets into this very strange thing, but I've seen luck have too much of a play in too many things. I'm 62. I've seen it happen too many times. Yeah, sometimes it's hard work, sometimes it's this, but luck is the most amazing thing.
Well, let's talk about hallucinogenic plants because I've come to the conclusion that it's best for me to take the hallucinogenic plants and fungi that grow indigenously in the homelands of where my ethnicity has been or evolved for thousands of years because I feel the land is a part of my racial memory, psyche, and mysticism, and it's a land where archetypes originated that suit the profile of my racial DNA and evolutionary path or collective soul of my people, I guess I could say. And so the plants in that area, I think, would maybe even have some vital things to share with me specifically about my family lineage. What do you think about that?
I think that's an absolutely great and incredibly well thought out orientation and very deep thinking, really. And a lot of people don't really seem to understand that in a lot of ways, the plants that grow around our houses, just even if you're looking at medicinal plants or within the ecosystem you're in, they're the most suitable medicinal plants because you're part of that ecosystem and they're dealing with all of the kinds of diseases you're dealing with. Plants get colds just like we do. That's why they make medicinal substances that also work for us. So when you move on to hallucinogenic plants, I mean, one of the fascinating things about them that I go into in the book in massive detail in Plant Intelligence and the Imaginal Realm is the way that they modulate the neural networks of every life organism on Earth. Plants get high on hallucinogens just the same way we do. The same things happen to them. So does every other animal that's ingested, and all animals do ingest hallucinogens. So for us, it makes a, you know, they people have to realize hallucinogens have been embedded into the Earth ecosystem for hundreds of millions of years. They're crucial. And so, for instance, psilocybin, which sends out your, you know, fungal tubes all underneath the soil that connect up all of the plants in a particular eco range, normally grassland ecozones, they hook into the plant neural networks. And what they do is then every so often they release psilocybin or psilocin, the hallucinogenic compounds, into the plant roots, and it alters the way that the plant brain perceives the world around it, and it allows it to innovate behaviors that are outside of habituated patterning. So part of what an organism, a human being even for instance, experiences when they take a hallucinogen is that they are able to get more deeply into what is called the metaphysical background of the world. They start to be able to see connections and deeper patterns, and then they're able to innovate behaviors on that depth of seeing. So when you're talking about doing that in your local range, you're so embedded there that it actually will connect you to deeper metaphysical understandings that are unique to the ecosystem from which you've emerged. And yeah, there's a lot of ancestral understandings in that place.
Would you say that the plant realm can be likened to the spiritual realm, or is it actually a plant realm that's more physical? I know it's hard to answer that.
Well, I actually love what the great Japanese farmer Masanobu Fukuoka said about that. He said, you know, you have to understand that if you kill nature, you kill God. And if you kill God, you kill nature. They're two sides of the same coin. One cannot exist without the other. And so there's a thing that happens during self-organization here that something more than the sum of the parts comes into being that can't be found in any of the parts. And it's part of this invisible realm that surrounds us every day of our lives, these particular kinds of living meanings. And so that's a very deeply spiritual world that human beings and all life forms have access to. And it's a crucially important dimension of the reality of this place that we're in. And that's one of the difficulties with reductive science. As James Hillman, the great Jungian scholar and teacher once put it, he goes, when science couldn't find the soul in the place they were looking, they gave up on the idea of the soul.
Yeah. So what state of perception is necessary, you think, for interacting with the plant realm?
I think the thing that's really important is to be able to work with meanings. Human beings know about that. They do it all of the time, like even though they're often shamed by reductive scientists. For instance, everybody knows that loves puppies, when you see a little puppy walking across the floor that doesn't see you yet, and then you call out to the puppy and it turns and looks at you, there's this exchange that happens. The puppy's face lights up and it's like, it's you, and this sort of energy comes out of the puppy into the human being, and something goes out of the person into the puppy. That's an exchange that we know about intimately every day of our lives, but yet there's no real word for it in our language. We do it with, we go to a restaurant to meet a friend, we're scanning the room, stranger, 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 and then we see our friend and she's right waving at us, and then there's that exchange of energy that happens again there. Gardeners know that a similar thing happens between them and their plants. Barbara McClintock, the great genomic scientist, corn researcher, said each one of these plants is its own individual human being or its own individual person. They have their lives, they have their struggles, and I have to know them. They're my friends. Mm-hmm. I really get down there and learn with them and become close with them, and I want to see how their lives turn out. She said, to be able to do this work, you must have a feeling for the organism. And that dynamic is that capacity for feeling rather than thinking is the thing that's fundamental. It's what pulls us deeper into an intimate embrace with the world where we start to be able to experience everything as intelligent and aware, and that we begin to notice the communications that are coming toward us from the world that happen every minute of our lives.
Oh, I have around 35 house plants, so I know what you're talking about. And for some reason, cats just love plants too. I don't know what it is.
They do. Well, most people that grow plants know that. And so it's sort of like science had to get caught up to where everybody was. So many of us have been taught to denigrate our natural experiences just because there's no real scientific proof for that. But science has only been around about 150 years in the form we think about it. And human beings have been around quite a bit longer than that. So have the rest of the life forms on the planet.
Now, I forgot to ask you, what is your take on paranoia while on a hallucinogenic journey? What is that?
There's human beings are really swarm intelligences. I talk about this a lot in there in the book, and everybody knows that. Everybody's been at a party one time or another when some other part of them took over their mouth and began talking and wouldn't relinquish control until they'd finished saying all the stupid things that were happening. Or, you know, just the thing of people would talk about, they'd move away from home and they'd go home and all of a sudden they'd be acting like an 8-year-old kid again. And they would go, I'm a grown up everywhere but here. So we know there's parts of us, or we get in the argument, eat the cake, don't eat the cake. So that dynamic, the part that gets paranoid during those events, is a particular part of the human being that when we get really high like that, there's a very vulnerable part of the self that's very similar to a really early infant stage. There's a kind of a wonder and an openness to the world. You see the world really with luminous eyes in this way that mostly children do. And that part is generally a very vulnerable part. It doesn't have a lot of capacity for armed resistance to the world, you might say. And so what happens is there's a part that naturally acts as sort of a protector for that young part of us. And when that part, the young part, gets sort of overexposed and there's not a lot of tools for how to take care of yourself, the other part just starts seeing danger everywhere. And that's sort of where it comes from. It takes a while to really learn how to work with paranoia and not let it bother you. You just sort of have to realize it'll pass and you just don't act on it when
just
it's
hang
happening.
On. Yeah. Well, a lot of people in the U.S. also smoke, I think, too much pot. So what do you think about marijuana?
I think marijuana is great. It's like I didn't really like it because I always used to get paranoid when I was a teenager for exactly the reasons I've just discussed. But when I went into middle age, for the first time in my life, I started to have insomnia. So I started smoking it at night. My son actually turned me on to it again. And it was the greatest medicinal aid to insomnia that I'd ever known. And I started to notice too, because I'm a writer and I write a massive amount of stuff, it really began to help my writing quite a bit. And so a lot of those ridiculous lies about how it screws up function, it's just, I mean, maybe for some people, but their function was going to be screwed up anyway. I mean, you look at Lee Child, who is also English, but he lives in the United States, and he writes all of the Jack Reacher mystery novels, and he writes every one of them as absolutely stoned as he can possibly be, and he's quite forthright about that. So I think it's a marvelous herb for human beings in many, many respects, and I have quite a lot of deep caring for it.
Yeah, I know in some places it's being legalized in America, and I almost wish it would stay on the black market because it seems like then it's going to be taxed and regulated to death. What do you think?
Oh, eventually it's going to get regulated. I mean, there's a big fight now. You know, the United States is going through one of its predictable Puritan upsurges of moral, you know, rectitude, you know, and it's just absolutely absurd and ridiculous. But nevertheless, in the election that happened yesterday, you know, two more states in the District of Columbia legalized marijuana. So now we're up to four states in the District of Columbia, and so it's slowly starting to happen. And yes, of course, they're going to tax it, and of course a lot of weird stuff's going to happen as this all gets worked out, but it's really a lot better than the thousands upon thousands of people that are in prison here. I mean, there's people in prison here for 30 or 40 years for possessing less than an ounce of marijuana. It's just intolerable.
Sure, of course, it's ridiculous. I mean, the whole idea of banning herbs is just ridiculous, you know?
Yeah, it's a bad thing. And, you know, that whole war on drugs that started in 72, it was, and most of the civil rights, the legislation that's been passed inhibiting civil rights in the United States and much of the Western world came from the drug war, and it's had a very horrible effect on civil liberties, and all the way around it was just a bad idea.
Well, the government's the biggest drug dealer there is, so there you go.
Yes, they are.
Well, Stephen, as we wind down, please give the audience your website details and let them know how they can find all your books.
Okay, it's gaianstudies.org, G-A-I-A-N, studies.org. And so my books are available through Amazon.com, pretty much everywhere, and many bookstores as well.
All right. Thank you, Stephen.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Wait just a minute, everyone. I have a confession to make. Remember I said I have 35 houseplants? Well, they're always talking to me. On various occasions, they've told me that they don't believe in egalitarianism, feminism, or the need for special rights. And they don't think about racism, political correctness, and poverty in the third world. And my plants only propagate offspring that looks just like they do. And get this, they also tell me that they love the green privilege I give them. So everyone, my plants are right-wing extremists. Well, folks, if you're feeling political and daring, be sure to check out my new video called St. George and the White Whore. Sound shocking? Well, it is, and it's available on the Red Ice Radio YouTube channel and on redicemembers.com. You can find Radio 314 on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Stitcher, iTunes, and on Google+. And of course, the websites are radio314.com, redicecreations.com, and redicemembers.com, where you can go to sign up for a membership to access all our material. Have a good one.
There is unrest in the forest. There is trouble with the trees. For the maples want more sunlight.